bleaching is becoming a major issue in our reefs today. The increased water temperature due to greenhouse gases and other human impacts are having a major effect, and this needs to be stopped. Corals have a symbiotic relationship with zooxanthellae. These tiny algae live in the tissues of the corals and provide the corals with their colour, primary source of food, and 90% of the energy that is required for the corals to grow and reproduce. When the water becomes polluted or the temperature rises, the coral can become stressed, which causes the algae to leave the tissues. When this happens, the coral is losing its food and colour source. This results in the coral turning white, becoming more susceptible to disease, and often resulting in the coral dying. In 2002, 60% of the coral reefs in the Great Barrier Reef were destroyed during a mass coral bleaching event. Corals play a very important role in the marine ecosystem, providing homes to many animals and helping with the diversity in our oceans. Not only do corals help with this aspect, but they also provide protection to the shoreline from wave action and tropical storms. They help with carbon and nitrogen fixing, help with nutrient recycling, and are the source of nitrogen and other essential nutrients for marine food chains. It is clear that coral bleaching is an issue that should be known and cared about worldwide, as corals are a very important aspect of the ecosystem and they need to be saved.
So where is it happening? The Great Barrier Reef experienced its most intensive and extensive coral bleaching events on record in early 1998. Broad-scale aerial surveys conducted of 654 reefs, 23% of which were on the Great Barrier Reef, in March and April 1998, showed that 87% of inshore reefs were bleached to some extent, compared to 28% of offshore reefs. 60% of those inshore reef corals had extreme levels of bleaching. 23 ground surveys that were conducted, which experienced bleaching intensities from none to extreme, showed that the aerial survey data are underestimating the true extent of coral bleaching on the Great Barrier Reef. The primary cause of this bleaching event is likely to be elevated sea temperature and solar radiation, intensified by lower salinity on inshore and some offshore reefs in the central Great Barrier Reef. So what are the effects of bleaching? Increased mortality rates in coral are one of the various effects of coral bleaching. The mortality of coral can vary among bleaching events, across large and small scales, and according to the affected taxa. Coral colonies may suffer from minor or absolute mortality. In latter research, larger coral colonies often experience partial mortality, whereas smaller colonies may suffer severely. The mortality rate of coral is generally low, and most corals recover from mild events. However, severe bleaching with high temperature anomalies that are occurring for extended periods of time can result in near 100% mortality, with even local extirpation of some taxa. The burning question is the recovery of coral reefs possible, and what are the conservation plans and implementations being put into the place to reduce it? The recovery process involved in bleached coral can vary greatly depending on the severity. Reefs suffering high coral mortality require a time-consuming recovery process of recolonization by coral larvae and asexual reproduction, such as by fragmentation, of corals that survived the event. Even under ideal conditions, coral recovery is slow and may take decades. Recovery of the reef can also depend on various components, such as sufficient connectivity between reefs to generate new larvae, good water quality, and strong herbivore populations present allows suitable substrate for the success of spawning and new recruitment. The implementation of local management and global stresses is required for the success of coral reef recovery, as they interact to determine the outcomes for reefs. Management tools, such as monitoring, transplantation, and marine protected areas, are among the few that can benefit the recovery of coral. Monitoring improves coral reef resilience by allowing the identification and protection of larval sources, connectivity patterns, and representative and replicated habitat types. Transplantation can enhance and contribute to coral resilience, where juveniles from a healthy coral reef are introduced onto a degraded one. This can reduce the burden of reproductive success on source reefs. Marine Protected Areas, or MPAs, reduce disturbances such as increased nutrient loads, pollution, diver and boat damage, sedimentation, and destructive overfishing. These reductions direct the stresses against bleaching by providing healthy corals' larval sources, which are essential for recovery. So why are the reefs important, and why does the conservation of it matter? The conservation of corals is important in modern Australia. Healthy coral reefs are among the most biologically diverse and economically valuable ecosystems on Earth. Coral ecosystems provide construction materials such as limestone. They protect coastlines from storms and erosion, and they are essential in spawning, nursery, breeding, and feeding grounds for numerous organisms for economically important fish species, and support more than 800 hard coral species and more than 4,000 species of fish. They provide jobs and income to local economies from fishing, tourism, and recreation, which can sometimes provide 80% of a country's total income. So how is the future looking if we maintain this position?
The future of the reef has many possible outcomes depending on what is done to aid in the end of the mass coral bleaching events that are taking place. As said previously, the Australian and Queensland governments have been working towards plans to ensure that by the year 2050, the reef will be stable and healthy. Although such action plans have been developed and laws have been introduced to help the reef, the number of bleaching increases dramatically each year. So where to now? Can the reef be brought back from the brink? Or what does the future hold for the great Australian icon if we maintain status quo, make minor changes, or major changes to the plans implemented now? The GBI Outlook Report 2014 has a section dedicated to the future of the reef and what is being done to help conserve the treasure. But the two main areas mentioned that they are trying to implement changes to are runoff and the traditional use of marine resources. This therefore means that the government are not trying to enforce within the community the amount of damage coral bleaching is doing and how everyone can help to save the reef. Drastic times call for drastic measures, and major changes would enable the reef to revive and survive. The monitoring of the coral reefs in place now to ensure bleaching events are known to researchers and can be watched closely to become more frequent and cover a larger span of the reef. More transplantation of corals to different locations to grow so they can be placed back into devastated areas is also a way that ensures the recovery of the reef as soon as possible. Everyone can help reduce their own carbon footprint, which in turn also helps the sea temperatures to decrease, which will result in less great bleaching events. The major changes do not have to be drastic. They must just be improvements from what is happening now to ensure that in 2015, the reef will be healthy and alive.
Based on the current knowledge of the Great Barrier Reef and the health of its coral-established ecosystem, the reef faces a range of increasing risks to the future of its prosperity. The identified threats to the region coral arise from several sources and are highly variable in both scale and time frame. Climate change is undoubtedly the main contributor when it comes to coral bleaching, as it instigates a kaleidoscope of knock-on effects. These effects include rising levels of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, such as ocean acidification, increased sea temperature, and rising sea levels, along with an intensification of extreme weather events. Other threats, like land-based runoff and coastal development, have obvious and indirect effects of the reef as well. These threats have the potential to work in a combination to weaken the resilience of the reef ecosystem and therefore its ability to recover from serious disturbances, such as major coral bleaching events that will become more frequent in the future. An increased understanding of the cumulative effects of the threats has highlighted the need for a management approach that takes into account all threats affecting an area and for a combination of reef-wide, regional, and local solutions.